Chapter 14. He was right, of course. I did not know what I was getting myself into. Years later, I silently thanked him for forcing me to postpone such decision until I was old enough to think for myself. But at the time, it was unforgivable. And it was typical of his behavior during those days. He had no boat crew to command, no income to manage, no trips to plan, not even a dining table to preside over. He would putter blandly along, then suddenly, unexpectedly, as if to remind himself he was still in charge of something, he would burst out like that. His intentions, right, but his manner, subordinate and relentless, forcing distances between us. As his youngest child, I had grown up blessed with special attention. Now, more and more, I found myself cut off from him. When I needed reassurance, I would get it from Woody or Chiez, or from Mama, who had more of herself to give by this time. Then one afternoon, there came a moment when I was cut off from both of them, Papa and Mama together. It wasn't lonesome, I felt, or isolation. They were still within reach. Rather, it was that first brief flicker of total separateness. It could have occurred anywhere we might have been living. I had reached the age. The scene happened to be set in one of those fire breaks at Mazanar. My oldest sister, Eleanor, figures it in. She lay in the camp hospital, trying to give birth to a baby she had thought she'd have in Reno, Nevada, where she and her husband, Singh, had relocated in 1943. Through friends, they had found a house there, and Singh lined up a job in a restaurant. Early in 1944, the government decided that Nazir should be eligible for selective service, like all other American citizens. A few months later, Singh was drafted. Eleanor, pregnant, could find neither work nor money enough to pay for having a baby. She couldn't stay in Reno, and she couldn't go with Singh to the Army's training camp in Louisiana, so she volunteered to re-enter camp. When she went into the hospital, it was time of great anxiety in our family. Two of my other sisters had born children there. They had both hemorrhaged badly, and blood plasma was in short supply, our needs being low on the wartime priority list. One sister might have died had not Woody provided blood by direct transfusion. In the case of a sister-in-law of ours who had miscarried and hemorrhaged, no one was able to arrest it in time, and she just bled to death in her hospital bed. These memories were very much with us. Papa, in particular, who worried. Eleanor was his oldest daughter, and this was her first child. Her husband had gone to Germany with the infantry division, and now she was struggling through the second day of a difficult labor. He and Mama were taking turns sitting with her. And what I remembered late the second afternoon is Mama running towards us from the other side of the fire break. I was walking with Papa as he started out for the hospital. And here she came, small and running, all bundled up. It was December, shouting, "Kyo, Kyo," making little puffs of frost in the icy air. I looked at Papa and his face was filled with terror. He tried to run to meet her, but couldn't, could barely keep his stride. His look filled me with terror too. I was sure Eleanor had died in the hospital. Our fear must have held back Mama's progress. It seemed we watched her run for minutes across the stretch of cleared sand. There was room enough for a football game or an entire parade. In my eyes then, it was a threatening openness at no man's land. We met her in the sand, Mama's breathless, some in front of him, looking up, saying, Kyo, Kyo, it's a boy. His face gave way. His eyes filled. A boy? Yes. And Eleanor? Yes, okay. Okay? They're both okay. His tears let go, unchecked. Mama was already crying. She began to talk excitedly, jabbering the details as the news sunk in. My fear was replaced by an odd detachment. The burden fell away, leaving me afloat. And I was a spectator, witnessing the nearness to a love scene I would ever see between them. My own perception removed me from it. I was more awed than aware, but I knew whatever I was watching was somehow both tender and profound, with an intimacy that made me invisible to them. Papa put an arm around her, needing her support. He was wearing the rust-colored turtleneck sweater he was used to take on his field fishing trips, the one she had knitted for him before the war. Now she was talking. The figures of one hand played over its yarn, as if inspecting her own workmanship. Now the late sun turned this rusty sweater dark shades of orange. They stood there in great expansion of the firebreak, far out from the rows of barracks, weeping with relief and happiness, talking quietly, just the two of them.